From the Fulton J. Sheen Center for Media Evangelization in Trenton, New Jersey, welcome to Come to Me with your host, Jim Manfredonia. Stay tuned for an hour of talk, discussion, and reflection on issues important to today's Catholics. And now, here is your host, Jim Manfredonia.
And a very good afternoon to you, my friends. Welcome once again to Come to Me. My name is Jim Manfredonia, and as always, it is a great joy to be here with you. As the Lord allows us this time every Monday through Thursday at 4 p.m. For Come to Me. And then on Fridays, when Gabriella and I bring you TGI Friday Live, I'm happy you're here. Hope you're celebrating today and having your carne, carnevale. And tomorrow, of course, is Ash Wednesday. And so we celebrate today, get ready for that wonderful Lenten journey that leads us to the glory of Easter. And I'm so happy that you are making domestic church media and our radio stations and our video, our Facebook Live, YouTube, however you're participating, part of your Lenten journey. And so what I'm going to do today is share with you some of our Holy Father's homily from this morning. And then the second half of the program will start and we'll conclude tomorrow our Holy Father's message for Lent 2017. As we get ready now for this season. You know, it seems to have come upon us quite quickly, rapidly, but it's late this year. Usually we're into Lent by now, but because Easter is, I think, as late as it can be, almost as late as it can be this year, being on the 16th of April, we're starting our Lenten time together a little later than normal. But praise God, we're here together, and I'm hoping that we here at Domestic Church Media will be helpful in your Lenten practices and your Lenten journey, your spiritual journey. So let's first, though, my friends, pray together as family wherever you are listening or watching. As I said, if you're listening live at 4 o'clock right now, we are on Facebook Live. You can go to facebook.com/domesticchurchmedia and watch the program live. We also upload it to our YouTube channel. So you can watch it later on. It's youtube.com/domesticchurchmedia. Of course, we're coming to you live on all four of our stations here in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, also on our streaming audio, on our mobile apps, and we'll have it available on podcast for you. So trying to use as many means of communications as possible, my friends, to fulfill our mission here at Domestic Church Media, to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ out into the world. And let's say our prayers, and then I have a couple of quick things I want to share with you before we get to the Holy Father's homily. So let's begin, my friends, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And first we pray for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, who just a couple weeks from today will be celebrating his fourth anniversary as our Holy Father. O God, who in your providential design willed that your church be built upon Blessed Peter, whom you set over the other apostles, look with favor, we pray, on Francis our Pope, and grant that he, whom you've made Peter's successor, may be for your people a visible source and foundation of unity in faith and of communion. And we ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And we'll pray our prayer for families. O dear Jesus, I humbly implore you to grant your special graces to our family. May our home be the shrine of peace, purity, love, labor, and faith. I beg you, dear Jesus, to protect and bless all of us, absent and present, living and dead. O Mary, Mother of Jesus and our Mother, pray to Jesus for our family, for all the families of the world, to guard the cradle of the newborn, the schools of the young, and their vocations. Blessed Saint Joseph, Holy Guardian of Jesus and Mary, assist us by your prayers in all necessities of life. Ask of Jesus that special grace which he granted to you, to watch over our home at the pillow of the sick and the dying, so that with Mary and with you, heaven may find our family unbroken in the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And we pray, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, we love you. Pray for us. Venerable Archbishop Sheen, pray for us. Saint John Paul II, pray for us. Our Lady of Good Remedy, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And again, I thank you, friends, for tuning in and being a part of this program. We're going to get to the Holy Father's homily from this morning a little later on, and then later, a little later on, we'll go and begin our sharing with you from his message for Lent 2017. But I do want to give a shout out. Didn't have a chance yesterday, had to put repeat on yesterday, but give a shout out, and Cheryl asked me to thank all of the good people who came to St. Magdalene's on Sunday to participate in Cheryl's music ministry concert up there at St. Magdalene's in Flemington. And she was thrilled, and I was thrilled, to see so many of our domestic church media family there who were there because they heard it promoted and advertised on the radio here. So I know it meant a lot to Cheryl. She had a wonderful gathering, and to the friends who came up and said hello to me and introduced themselves, I'm happy you did that. And just thanks again for being there and participating in what was a beautiful afternoon of giving glory to God in song. So Cheryl did ask me to extend that her thanks to you for being there, being a part of that. And it was wonderful. And I didn't get a chance to go to the men's conference on Saturday. I had another obligation, but I understand that it was a wonderful event. So congratulations again to Bill Maher and George Rose, our friends who host their program here on the radio on our stations, but who are part of the Catholic Men for Jesus Christ organization, who sponsored that annual event, the 20th annual Catholic Men for Jesus Christ conference. And it was a great success. I understand a lot of people there, and we had a presence there, although, as I said, I wasn't there, but we had representation there. So thanks to everybody who participated, and we'll look forward to hearing about it, I'm sure, on Friday, next Friday. No, this Friday. My goodness, it's first Friday already, when Bill and George bring us Brothers in Arms, and I'm sure they'll recap the conference. So a lot of good things happening, my friends, and I'm so thrilled and so happy that you allow us to be a part of your day. And we are certainly most grateful to Almighty God for your friendship, your support, and your being here and being a part of our family. It means a lot to us. Now, as we start this Lenten season together, we do have some special programming coming up through our affiliation with EWTN. But I'm you know, one time many years ago, at the parish where Cheryl and I attended, a dear woman came up to Cheryl one day after Mass and said that she normally, and it was the beginning of Lent, and that she normally listens to National Public Radio. She said, but as a Lenten penance, she was going to listen to Catholic radio. So if that's what it is, listen, I'm happy. Maybe I can be your penance. I know there are a lot of people out there who probably could make listening to this program their Lenten penance. Do that. I would appreciate that. I think that would be nice. But I do hope, seriously, folks, that you do listen to the many programs we offer here to enhance your spiritual journey through Lent. You know, you hear, I was going over some things we were looking through the other day that we found here, and kind of we're trying to put together a little archive, because we have so much material over the past more than 20 years in which I've been involved in Catholic radio. But I found a newspaper article from 1997, so 20 years ago, on Cheryl and me and the music that we were doing. And there's a little story in there about having just met Mother Angelica and starting Catholic radio in the area, or hoping to anyway. And it's wonderful to see how God's hand has gently led not just us. And again, I say that, trust me, in with great humility, because it's not just us. There are so many people in the course of this progression that domestic church media is, this wonderful opportunity of using whatever means we can get our hands on to open them up to proclaim the Word of God. And we have binders and binders and stacks and stacks. And I just saw some, I was reading them earlier this afternoon, from the late 1990s, after we first went on the air with, and I was doing this program and buying time on a station in Camden, New Jersey. And the letters from people who were thanking God for the advent of Catholic radio in the area, which is what that was at the time, which has now evolved, of course, into what domestic church media has become. And again, through no merit of our own, but by God's grace. And as I look over the course, you know, the past 20, 25 years of my life, and what God has allowed to happen, I mean, I'm so overwhelmed by the goodness and the many graces and blessings that God has bestowed on me, my family, the apostolate, and all the wonderful people. We were this afternoon, earlier this morning, Gabriella and I were interviewing Patty Staley for one of our Friday segments, and I was trying to remember how Patty Staley, who does such a wonderful job on Catholic Matters every week, and has been doing it for 7 years, I think now, and even how that happened. And Patty was telling me, she had to remind me how I asked her to do this, but really it was really the Holy Spirit working through me, and how things are meant to be, and how good people like Patty Staley, like Gabriella Fermato, and others who have come into this building and have become part of the family. I'm noted in sometimes in a way for what people laugh at my vetting processes on getting people, allowing people to participate in the apostolate. But it really is with great, great discernment and prayer and love because this is such an important thing for me. That what goes out over these airwaves really exhibits the joy of the church and proclaims that and makes that known, the joy of the church through the joy of the gospel. So anyway, I don't know how I got on that, but hey, let's thank God for that, and let's go to the Holy Father. This is his homily from this morning this is not from this morning. I must have printed off the wrong one. Oh, I'm sorry. This is from Sunday. Sunday's homily. That's the 26th, right? Yeah. Okay. Sunday's homily. Well, good, though. This is I didn't see this morning, but I'm sure this is going to apply. Someone had to hear this today. Maybe me. Holy Father said, while earthly pleasures, such as power and money, bring temporary satisfaction, they are ultimately fleeting and deceptive. And he explained that God alone is faithful, and in trusting in him, we have nothing to worry about. We remember Sunday's gospel, you know, that don't worry about tomorrow. Don't worry, you know. Holy Father said, God is not a distant and anonymous being. He is our refuge, the source of our serenity and our peace. He is the rock of our salvation, to whom we can cling with the certainty of not failing. He is our defense against the evil that is always lurking. And maybe this is for me, because I'm reading this, I think I'm just having reflected a little bit on over the past 20 to 25 years in doing this work. And I can cite many, many times where, as our friend Father Groeschel promised me would happen, the Lord will took us right to the edge, teaching us how we shouldn't be afraid. We need to trust. We need to trust. If you're a regular listener to this program, you've heard me talk occasionally about the picture I have in my office mounted on the wall. It's a reprint of a Rembrandt, Our Lord Calms the Storm. And it's the boat in the rough seas with all the apostles and Jesus asleep at the stern. And the first time I saw that picture many years ago, I said, when I get my own office in this Catholic radio station, I want that picture in there. Because people have walked into my office and have said to me, this is true. People have actually, when they walked into my office, said, but Jim, before we begin, I have to ask you a question. Why do you have that picture there? Because it's a big print framed behind my chair. I said, because every day when I walk into this office, I look at that picture. And in that picture, and look, you can look, if you Google it, you can find it. You can see the picture. It's Rembrandt's Jesus Calms the Storm. In that picture, the 12 are in there with our Lord. But every one of the 12 is doing something different. And they're all reacting and responding differently to the storm. The boat itself, you see, is being tossed. The waves are coming over the side, and but you see, a couple of the apostles are trying to steady the sail. One of them is bailing out water. One of them is hanging over the side, getting sick to his stomach. One of them, you know, and of course, then there's the beloved apostle who's there with the Lord, kind of just being with him. And I said to this person, and as I said, a few people have asked me this question when they saw that picture. I said, because when I walk into my office every morning, I look at that picture and I say, okay, Lord, which one of these apostles do you want me to be today? Because I know there's going to be storm. I know it's going to be rough. How do you want me to, who am I going to be today? Am I going to be the one who's trying to steady the sail? Am I going to be the one who's trying to bail out the water? Am I going to be the one leaning over the side, throwing up? Am I going to be the one who's just very, very peaceful and calm there, relaxing with Jesus? But that's the story of apostolate. That's the story of discipleship. And what our Lord tells us throughout the Bible. Now, I had the homily I heard on Sunday, and I have to excuse myself. I can't remember the good priest's name. It was over at St. Michael's in Levittown, young priest. And I've seen him before, and he's a wonderful homilist. But he said that the phrase that appears most in the Bible, more than any other phrase, is do not be afraid or be not afraid throughout the Bible. And I did see one time someone said that those words, be not afraid, appear in the Bible 365 times. I don't know that that's a fact. The point was being made that there was one for every day of the year. Don't be afraid. And so the Holy Father on Sunday was reflecting on that gospel and talking about what a friend we have in God, a great friend, an ally, and father, Pope Francis said. But he noted, sadly, that we don't always realize that. He said, we don't realize that we have a friend, a father who loves us. We prefer to cling to immediate and contingent goods, forgetting and at times refuting the supreme good, which is the paternal love of God. Holy Father said, to know and feel that God is our Father is especially important in this age of what the Holy Father called orphanhood. And he noted that oftentimes we distance ourselves from God's love when we go in obsessive pursuit of earthly goods and riches, thus showing an exaggerated love of these realities. Many friends, or those whom we think are friends, delude us with false illusions, the Holy Father said, but stress that God never deludes us. So again, this whole reality that our Father who created us, who created everything that is not a distant and an anonymous being. Holy Father reminds us that He is our refuge, the source of our serenity and our peace. He's the rock of our salvation. He's our friend, our ally, our father. But sadly, we don't realize that. We seek and we pursue the things of the world to give us satisfaction, or which is, of course, temporary and fleeting. And we have to look to God, our Father, as the loving Father that He is. And if we're you know, this time that we're entering into tomorrow, this beautiful season of Lent, is a time that gets us ready, you know, to remind us that we are creatures, that we have a Father who created us, and that one day we will return to the dust from which we came, although our immortal soul will live on forever. But this world and the world as we know it will one day pass. We will pass, but we know that our Father did not create us for death. He created us for eternal life. And the Holy Father Sunday said, again, focusing on Sunday's gospel passage, in which Matthew writes that and tells the disciples that no one can serve two masters, and that they don't need to worry about necessities in life such as food, shelter, or clothing, because your Heavenly Father knows you need them. The Holy Father said, the passage serves as a strong call to trust in God. explaining that God's benevolent and responsive gaze watches over each of us on a daily basis. The gaze often flows beneath the worry of many concerns, Pope Francis taught, which risk taking away serenity and balance. But he noted that this anxiety is often useless because it isn't able to change the course of events. You know, one time Bishop Sheen, Venerable Archbishop Sheen, said that anxiety, to be anxious about something, now I'm not talking about the mental disorder of it, because we know there are people who suffer severe anxiety. But people who get anxious, you know, where it's not a debilitating condition, but people who get anxious about things or worry about things. Bishop Sheen, Venerable Sheen, one time said, this could be considered to be atheistic in nature because it shows a lack of trust in God. And he referred then, as Holy Father refers now or Sunday, on the gospel passage when Jesus tells us not to worry about tomorrow because there is a loving Father who never forgets his children. And while trusting in him doesn't magically resolve our problems, it allows us to confront them with the right spirit. I remember one time, I could tell you story after story about this. I know I've shared this with you, but this is a vivid image I have in my head and I've had for many, many years. Before we had any of our radio stations, and when I was in transition, there was a period of about a year and a half where I was literally out of work trying to get Catholic radio established over here in Jersey and Pennsylvania. And the previous position I was in, I was let go, and so I had no job. But I remember working diligently every day in one way or another to do whatever I could in response to God's prompting to meet the right people, set up the right meetings, make the right phone calls, be in the right place at the right time. Spent a lot of time in adoration with Jesus, a lot of time with the Lord that year and a half, a lot of time, trust me. But I remember one spring afternoon in that time, it was a beautiful spring day. It was warm, and so I went out in my backyard, and we have a little cement slab patio there, and I sat down in the chair, and the sun, my backyard faces the west, so the sun was starting to shine right, you know, into that area. And I remember sitting there just soaking up some sun, exasperated, thinking, Lord, I've been working so hard on this, and nothing seems to be happening. Is this what you really want? Is this where you really want me to be? And all of a sudden, I was sitting very still. I was probably half asleep in a sense, but very still, very calm. All of a sudden, now this is early spring, so I had not yet cut the back lawn, but you know, the grass was growing higher and there was, of course, some weeds popping up. But I don't know what type of growth it was coming out of the ground, but all of a sudden, this large flock of sparrows descended on my backyard, and they were all picking at the seeds from the grass and the weeds that were there, and they were having a feast. I guess they didn't know I was there, or they thought I was part of the furniture or something, or a statue. So I tried not to move, just watched them. And I could, although not audibly hear, but I could feel the Lord very clearly speak to my heart, Jimbo. Look it, I'm feeding those birds. They're having a feast. Do you think that I would care any more for them than I would for you? Don't worry. It'll happen. I'll take care of things. And I felt a very calming peace come over me and the anxiety dissipate. Because it was the Lord saying, just trust me. And this is what the gospel is speaking about. Trusting in God who does not delude, the Holy Father said on Sunday, telling the pilgrims, get busy as faithful administrators of the goods that he's given us, and even the earthly ones, but without overdoing it, as if everything or even our salvation depend only on us. Turning to the gospel verse where Jesus says, you cannot serve both God and mammon. The Holy Father said it has to be either the Lord or fascinating but illusory idols. This is the course, the choice we are called to make, but not just once, Pope Francis said, but in all our actions, programs, and commitments. It's a choice to make in a clear way and to continuously be renewed, because the temptations of reducing everything to money, power, and pleasure are relentless. Now, I didn't watch the Academy Awards the other night, but I saw the clip at the end. It's kind of God has a great sense of humor, you know, doesn't he? Doesn't he have a great sense of humor? Anyway, but you know, there are a lot of people out there with a lot of money and a lot of possessions. And it's not limited to entertainers and sports figures. I was watching the other night, flipping through the channels, and it was something about they actually have a channel called the Wealth Channel. I guess it's to make people like us watch it and say, gee, look at all those people with all that money. I always think when I see these people, like, okay, look, where are you? I want the phone number or the address. I got to go see that person. They're spending $2.5 million on a yacht for pleasure. And it's like throwaway money to them. $2.5 million to Domestic Church Media would, my goodness, get us another radio station up north. Anyway, point is, that stuff's not going to satisfy us. It may satisfy us temporarily, like a new toy for a child, but it goes away. We need to get away from these false idols, Pope Francis said. We need to get away from these fleeting false idols. And we have to go and trust in God. He said, Christian hope is stretched to the future fulfillment of God's promise, and it does not cease before difficulty because it is founded on fidelity to God, which never fails. And he closed his address on Sunday, Pope Francis did, as Angelus, by praying that Mary, our Blessed Mother, would help each person to entrust themselves to the love and goodness of the Heavenly Father and to live both with and in him. He said, this is the prerequisite for overcoming the torments and adversities of life and even persecutions, as the witness of many of our brothers and sisters shows us. And then he prayed the Angelus with them. But I think one of the things, now we're on the eve of entering into the beautiful season of Lent. Tomorrow's Ash Wednesday, and I'm sure most people are trying to prepare, you know, what am I giving up? How am I going to change? The whole purpose of this is to make us a better person on Easter Sunday than we were on Ash Wednesday, to make us a holier person, most important, on Easter Sunday than we were on Ash Wednesday. What's going to get us there? Now, you know, we're trained as children to you know, think about giving up candy and sweets or certain foods and things. That's all well and good. But think about what it is, whether it is through mortification. But remember, Lent is a season of prayer, fasting, and almsgiving. By all three of those practices, in how we adapt it to our own particular life, who we are, how we're going to get through the next 6 weeks, what is going to make us holier on Easter Sunday than we were on Ash Wednesday? And first and foremost, trust in God. Walk with him. Walk with the Lord. Trust in Jesus. Allow ourselves to be led and guided by him through this Lenten season. And that's going to be a big help to us as well. Now, I'm going to take a break. When I come back, I want to start with you. We won't do the whole thing today, but we'll continue it tomorrow on Ash Wednesday. But I want to start with you. The message from Pope Francis for Lent 2017. So, my friends, you stay where you are, and I will be right back. My friends, it's part of our mission here at WFJS to build awareness about what's going on in the world that Catholics need to know and understand.
And we'd like to call your attention to a wonderful resource that we have here in the Diocese of Trenton that shares our mission to feed the Catholic community, the diocesan newspaper, The Monitor.
The Monitor is an important source of news and information for us and delivers a wide range of content to its readers, both in print and online.
Bishop O'Connell regularly uses The Monitor, just as he does with his monthly radio program here on WFJS, to reach out to his people and make them aware of critical issues as well as developments within the diocese.
Subscribing to The Monitor is easy. For the special price of $25 per year, you can have 26 issues delivered right to your home.
And included in that price, you also get an online subscription, so we encourage you to subscribe today.
Go to TrentonMonitor.com or call 609-403-7129.
This is a message from the Diocese of Trenton. Catholic schools in New Jersey save taxpayers millions of dollars each year. Currently, the amount of funding available for non-public school busing is insufficient to provide safe and secure rides for all students who wish to attend a Catholic school. Transportation is the lifeblood of our schools, and you can make a difference. For more information and to find out how you can help, visit njcatholic.org/transportation. Thank you very much.
Want to work a virtual miracle for your church or charity? Here's something so brilliant yet so simple and meaningful, you have to check it out. It's an internet site called GoodShop.com. GoodShop.com has created a way that lets you support any charity of your choice, and it costs you nothing. The good news is, 700 of the largest internet retailers, stores you already visit online, have teamed up with GoodShop.com to give back a percentage of every purchase you make to your favorite cause. Before you buy anything online, go to GoodShop.com, select the charity you care about most, and then click over to your favorite store. Shop as you normally would, pay nothing extra, and a donation will be made to your favorite charity. It's that easy.
Visit GoodShop.com today and designate Domestic Church Media as your favorite charity, and a portion of your internet purchase will be donated to Domestic Church Media and enable us to continue to bring you outstanding Catholic radio. That's GoodShop.com, and designate Domestic Church Media as your favorite charity. GoodShop.com.
Our family is made up of every race. We are young and old, rich and poor, men and women, sinners and saints. Our family has spanned the centuries and the globe. With God's grace, we started hospitals to care for the sick. We establish orphanages and help the poor. We are the largest charitable organization on the planet, bringing relief and comfort to those in need. We educate more children than any other scholarly or religious institution. We developed the scientific method and laws of evidence. We founded the college system. We defend the dignity of all human life and uphold marriage and family. Guided by the Holy Spirit, we compiled the Bible. We are transformed by sacred scripture and sacred tradition, which have consistently guided us for 2,000 years. We are the Catholic Church, with over 1 billion in our family, sharing in the sacraments and fullness of the Christian faith. Jesus laid the foundation for our faith when he said to Peter, the first pope, "You are a rock, and upon this rock I will build my church." For over 2,000 years, we've had an unbroken line of shepherds, guiding us with love and truth. If you've been away from the Catholic Church, we invite you to take another look. Visit CatholicsComeHome.org today. Ours is one family, united in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We are Catholic. Welcome home.
From Fallsington to Fort Monmouth.
Point Pleasant to Pennington.
Seagirt to Spotswood.
From Yardley to Yardville.
Silverdale to Seagirt.
Southampton to Seaside Heights.
Proclaiming the joy of the gospel on Domestic Church Catholic Radio. All right, welcome back. And we're going to get to the Holy Father's message for Lent this year in just a moment. First, though, a few announcements I want to make you aware of, some things going on. Our friends up in Lambertville, New Jersey, at St. John the Evangelist Church, are hosting an evening that they're calling the Shroud Encounter. This is March 11th. From 6 to 7:30 p.m., St. John's in Lambertville will be hosting Shroud Encounter, a production of the Shroud of Turin Education Project, and will be presented by international expert Russ Brault. He has been featured on several national documentaries seen on CBS, the History Channel, EWTN, and Discovery. A museum-quality life-size replica of the Shroud will be on display. So nice Lenten activity. This is March 11th, 6 o'clock in the evening. It's free, open to the public. St. John the Evangelist Parish Church at 44 Bridge Street in Lambertville, a beautiful church. We were there last year, I think. A presentation on the Shroud, plus an authentic life-size replica of the Shroud will be on display. So that's neat. Also, let's see, the annual St. Patrick's Day Mass at Immaculate Conception Church, Friday, St. Patrick's Day, March 17th, 12:15. That's at 540 Chestnut Avenue in Trenton. You'll be hearing bagpipes again as Our Lady of the Angels Parish, Immaculate Conception Church, located at 540 Chestnut Avenue in Trenton. The Mass will be spoken in Gaelic and English, celebrated by Monsignor Michael J. Walsh, pastor of St. James Church, and Father Cesar Rubiano. A bagpiper will be playing Irish tunes, greeting the participants arriving at the church that day. So that's March 17th, 12:15 in the afternoon at Immaculate Conception Church, 540 Chestnut Avenue. And another fine Catholic tradition in Lent, our friends over at St. Michael the Archangel Parish in Levittown, they're going to have their Lenten fish dinners every Friday evening, starting on March 10th. Right? What's the start date? I guess so, March 10th. 5 to 8 p.m., and it's adults $10, senior citizens $8, children $6, baked fish, French fries, Italian bread, tossed salad, assorted desserts, coffee, tea, soda, or water. So that starts on Friday, March 10th. I guess they're not having it the 17th, though. I see it goes from the 10th to the 24th, so because St. Patrick's Day. But starting the 10th, the Lenten Fish Dinner at St. Michael the Archangel in Levittown, 66 Levittown Parkway. And okay, so some things. Now, these and many other announcements can be found on our website, on our bulletin board, domesticchurchmedia.org, and then click on the bulletin board link, and you can find these events as well as others. If you have an event coming up that you'd like posted on our website, when you go to that site, domesticchurchmedia.org, click on the bulletin board link. There is a form, an event form you can fill out. Submit it. We get it. We'll post it. I can't announce all of them on the program, but I try to pick in, you know, a few out every day and give you some verbal announcements here on this program as we do on Friday. So it's free. Take advantage of it. You know, we're here to serve our Catholic community. And you never know who's listening. You know, I mentioned I've been doing this for a long, long time. And we, consistently through the years, people have been, you know, we'd hear from people who say, I found you by accident. You hear of conversions. You hear of people who have been healed spiritually. And so you never know. So take advantage of it. We'd love to make post it on our website and make the announcement for you. All right, let's go to Holy Father's message for Lent. And as I said, we'll start it today. We'll finish it up tomorrow. These are the words from Holy Father Pope Francis for Lent 2017. Lent is a new beginning, he said, a path leading to the certain goal of Easter, Christ's victory over death. This season urgently calls us to conversion. Again, that's the whole reason for it, my friends. It's not to give up certain foods so we'll lose weight or, you know, we want to be a holier person on Easter Sunday than we were on Ash Wednesday. Conversion. The Holy Father said this season urgently calls us to conversion. He said Christians are asked to return to God with all their hearts, to refuse to settle for mediocrity, and to grow in friendship with the Lord. Jesus is the faithful friend who never abandons us, even when we sin. He patiently awaits our return. By that patient expectation, he shows us his readiness to forgive. A great time as disciples, and missionaries, friends. That's what we are by virtue of our baptism. It's a great time to reach out, gently reach out to others who we know should be practicing Catholics but aren't. It's also a great time to evangelize to people who aren't Catholic and to share with them the joy of this season, the joy of our faith. Holy Father said, Lent is a favorable season for deepening our spiritual life through the means of sanctification offered us by the Church, fasting, prayer, and almsgiving. At the basis of everything is the Word of God, which during this season we are invited to hear and ponder more deeply. He said, I would like to consider the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Let us find inspiration in this meaningful story, for it provides a key to understanding what we need to do in order to attain true happiness and eternal life. It exhorts us to sincere conversion. That's the story of life. Conversion. Now, there's a wonderful scene. One of my favorite books, because I have read it a number of times, and more often, though, the film, I know we're talking about Lent and Easter, but the film, The Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens, which is a story of redemption. It's a story of conversion. I think it'd be neat to read that story as part of read the book. Don't put the movie on. Read the book during Lent, The Christmas Carol. I'm not losing my mind. I'm just saying it's a story of conversion. It's a story of redemption. There's a scene in that film where Ebenezer Scrooge's partner, they were in partnership together, you know, Ebenezer Scrooge and Jacob Marley. I was going to say Bob Marley, but no, Jacob, not Bob Marley, man. Jacob Marley is dying. Now, Scrooge and Marley had been, just ruthless in their business practices. But Jacob Marley is dying on his bed, and Scrooge goes to see him on that Christmas Eve when Jacob Marley died. And Marley says to Scrooge, he could barely speak, but he's pointing, save yourself. There's still time. Save yourself. That's what this season of Lent is all about. While we still have time, we have time to save ourselves, in a sense, through prayer, fasting, almsgiving, and the many, many ways the Church offers us. It is a time of conversion. And then the Holy Father, again, talking about the rich man and Lazarus. He says the parable begins by presenting its two main characters. The poor man is described in greater detail. He is wretched and lacks the strength even to stand. Lying before the door of the rich man, he fed on the crumbs falling from his table. His body is full of sores, and dogs come to lick the wounds. Holy Father says, this picture is one of great misery. It portrays a man disgraced and pitiful. And Pope Francis says, this scene is even more dramatic if we consider that the poor man is called Lazarus, a name full of promise, which literally means God helps. And I didn't know that. Lazarus means God helps. The character is not anonymous. His features are clearly delineated, and he appears as an individual with his own story. While practically invisible to the rich man, we see and know him as someone familiar. He becomes a face, and as such, a gift, a priceless treasure, a human being whom God loves and cares for, despite his concrete condition as an outcast. Pope Francis said, Lazarus teaches us that other persons are a gift. A right relationship with people consists in gratefully recognizing their value. Even the poor person at the door of the rich man is not a nuisance, but a summons to conversion and to change. Isn't that interesting? You think about all the people that we encounter, all the situations that our Lord allows us to enter into in the course of any given day. All the things that come our way about which we have to make decisions. The Holy Father said that really, in a sense, if we look at it, all these could be a summons to conversion and to change. The parable, Pope Francis said, first invites us to open the doors of our hearts to others because each person is a gift, whether it be our neighbor or an anonymous pauper. Lent is a favorable season for opening the doors to all those in need and recognizing in them the face of Christ. Each of us meets people like this every day. Each life that we encounter is a gift deserving acceptance, respect, and love. You know, I'm on Facebook. I got on Facebook when my kids went away to college. So they had to friend me so I could see what they were writing about, things that were going on in their lives. I see some things on Facebook now and have been over the past year or so because of the divisiveness in this country, the way people talk about each other, the things they say about each other. You know, we have the right to disagree over issues. You know, I have a good friend, I should say, an old friend that I was very good friends with when I was growing up. He's now a psychologist in Texas, and we're Facebook friends, and he's on the complete opposite end of the political fence as me. We're just complete opposites. And I after the election in November, you know, he made a comment. Now, it wasn't a negative comment against me, but just about the president-elect and the situation. I said, you know, we have to really be careful about how we express ourselves. Because once you start making it personal, then that's how relationships are destroyed. You can disagree over issues, over, you know, politics, but once you start getting into the personal attacks, then it becomes damaging. And we have to, as Holy Father said here, we have to see in the people we meet the good in everybody. There is, you know, we're all created in God's own image and likeness. Even those with whom we vehemently disagree. You know, I know I'm speaking right now to a majority, if not all, pro-life audience. And we know there are people in the world, we all know them even probably personally, who are the complete opposite of that, who would do anything they possibly could to ensure that abortion remained a legal option for women. And we loathe that position. We despise that position. We hate that position as pro-lifers. But we certainly can't loathe, despise, or hate the person. It's not easy sometimes, I know, but we can't. We have to love the people. And so Holy Father says that, you know, we encounter people every day, and we have to see in them and recognize the face of Christ. Each of us meets people like this every day. Each life that we encounter is a gift deserving acceptance, respect, and love. Doesn't mean you have to accept, respect, and love what the sin they're involved in or position they have, but you have to love, respect, and accept the individual. The Word of God helps us to open our eyes to welcome and love life, especially when it is weak and vulnerable. But in order to do this, we have to take seriously what the gospel tells us about the rich man. Pope Francis said the parable is unsparing in its description of the contradictions associated with the rich man. Unlike poor Lazarus, he does not have a name. He is simply called a rich man. His opulence was seen in his extravagant and expensive robes. Purple cloth was even more precious than silver and gold, and thus reserved for kings, while fine linen gave one an almost sacred character. The man was clearly ostentatious about his wealth and in his habit of displaying it daily. And he quotes verse 19, he feasted sumptuously every day. In him, we can catch a dramatic glimpse of the corruption of sin, which progresses in three successive stages: love of money, vanity, and pride. You ever think about that? Sin progressing in three successive stages: love of money, vanity, and pride. Pope Francis said the Apostle Paul tells us that the love of money is the root of all evils. The love of money is the root of all evils. It is the main cause of corruption and source of envy, strife, and suspicion. Money can come to dominate us, even to the point of becoming a tyrannical idol. Instead of being an instrument at our service for doing good and showing solidarity toward others, money can chain us and the entire world to a selfish logic that leaves no room for love and hinders peace. You know, there was a time, and I'm not, I'm a man of meager means here, trust me. We're not in this operation, in this business, in this employ to make money. I will be honest, we are compensated for the work we do here, but that's a fair compensation according to God's justice, you know. But what, you know, we know there are people out there who make a lot of money. In their eyes, it's not a lot of money. You could say $1-3 million to some people. That's not a lot of money. To us, it's like unreachable, unfathomable. How do you even get that? But that's the point, is that, unfortunately, as Holy Father said, sin progresses in these three successive stages, the first being a love of money. There's no sin in having money. There's no sin in wealth. But loving money, making that money your idol, and everything revolves around your money, that's a very dangerous position to take. Very dangerous. And then the parable, Pope Francis said, shows the rich man's greed making him vain. His personality finds expression in appearances, in showing others what he can do, but his appearance masks an interior emptiness. His life is a prisoner to outward appearances, to the most superficial and fleeting aspects of existence. The lowest rung of this moral degradation is pride, Pope Francis said. The rich man dresses like a king and acts like a god, forgetting that he is merely mortal. How many people do we know, unfortunately, like that, either personally or just know of them based on things we've seen and read? People who think, I like this, dressing like a king and acting like a god, forgetting that they're mere mortals. You know, when we leave this earth, we're going to go out the same way we came in, naked and with nothing. Father Mitch Packer, one time I never forget, it was Father Mitch Packer, or I can't think of his name, the priest who used to be with Jeanette Benkovic, but you never see a U-Haul trailer attached to a hearse. Not taking any of it with us. We're going out naked with nothing. That's how we're going to stand before Almighty God. He's not going to ask how much money we have. Oh, he may ask us, what did we do with the money he gave us? He's not going to ask to see our bank accounts or our homes or our cars. But he will hold us accountable for what we did with what we had. Those who are corrupted by love of riches, Pope Francis said, nothing exists beyond their own ego. Those around them do not come into their line of sight. The result of attachment to money is a sort of blindness. The rich man does not see the poor man who is starving, hurting, and lying at his door. Interesting, isn't it? The result of attachment to money is a sort of blindness. As I said, I was watching this TV program the other night on the Wealth Channel. I think it's funny they have a channel called the Wealth Channel. They should have a channel called the Poor Saps Channel. We could all be on that one. What, the Wealth Channel? And they were showing this older couple. I say older, they probably were my age. Maybe a little older than me. In the market for a yacht. They always wanted a yacht. And the woman says, I always wanted to just go sailing off the Amalfi Coast. Don't we all, sweetheart? But they had the means to make it happen, I suppose, because they were shopping for yachts in the price range of $2 to $2.5 million just to have a yacht, a 100-and-some-foot yacht that had like 3 bedrooms, 2 baths. It was like a house, but beautiful, fine wood. And I thought, there's nothing wrong with that, as long as they're equally spending money on things to serve their brothers and sisters. That's I always thought, you know, if I ever was blessed enough to, I shouldn't say blessed, cursed enough to have a lot of money, I would like to think that for whatever I spent on a luxury perhaps, or something that I always wanted, I would spend equal or more on clothing the naked and feeding the hungry. It balances it out. You know, all right, yeah, I bought myself a yacht, but I also gave $2.5 million to St. Jude, you know, hospital. I don't know if that's right or not. It's just my own philosophy. I'll never get there anyway, so it makes no difference. But the Wealth Channel cracks me up, because it, just to have a channel dedicated to wealthy people. Listen, I don't mean to offend any of you. If you're wealthy and you're listening and you watch that channel, we love you. And I know you love us too. So I know you'll support us too with some of that that you have. Okay, listen, I'm going to stop there. We'll pick it up tomorrow. And conclude tomorrow's Ash Wednesday, of course, we'll conclude the Holy Father's message for Lent. But I see I have like 30 seconds left, so I don't want to start the next section. In the meantime, my friends, I want to remind you that, of course, this program does air live at 4 o'clock. And when we do, we're also live on Facebook, facebook.com/domesticchurchmedia. We also upload the video to our YouTube channel. We have other videos on there. You can watch other programs, youtube.com/domesticchurchmedia. We repeat at 10 o'clock at night. We put it on podcast. We have free mobile apps and all kinds of ways you can listen to Domestic Church Media. So I thank you for being here, being a part of my day. Please support us. You know, Lent is a time of prayer, fasting, and what's that? Almsgiving. We certainly would appreciate some of your alms this Lent. Domestic Church Media, P.O. Box 7509, Trenton, 08628. Or make an online donation at domesticchurchmedia.org. That's domesticchurchmedia.org. My name is Jim Manfredonia. Thank you for listening. May God bless you. God love you. Have a happy and holy rest of your day.
Women of Grace
with Jeanette Bekovic.